संदीप गिरी हैज टॉट मोर देन 1000 स्टूडेंट्स प्रोफेशनल्स प्रोफेसर्स अबाउट आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस मशीन लर्निंग बिग डेटा ही हैज वर्कड विद एमेजॉन ही हैज वर्कड विद इनबीडी ही हैज वर्कड विद अ लॉट ऑफ स्टार्टअप्स एंड इवन यूनिवर्सिटीज सो ही हैज अ वास्ट एक्सपीरियंस इन दिस फील्ड एंड ही इज द बेस्ट पर्सन टू टेक दिस मास्टर का क्लास which is truly coming from someone who has done this again and again. He has not just built stuff using machine learning, he has also taught people, more than 1,000 people. He is going to present getting started with machine learning on Git Commit Show today. So I will hand it over to Sandeep Giri. I'm so excited. I have started my laptop as well, and I'm going to learn about machine learning for the first time, and I'm very excited about this. So handing over to you, Sandeep, thanks a lot for joining us, and you can start from here.
All right, so I hope you are able to hear me, and let me just get the control of my screen. All right, so great, and oh, it's so awkward to see your own face on the screen. All right. Great to have. Hi there, wherever you are. So great to have this wonderful conference. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk you through the basic terms of machine learning. And then after the basic terms, I'm going to walk you through. Just give me a moment. So first, we are going to walk through the basic terms in machine learning, and then we are going to do hands-on. So be with me, and if you are logged in from the mobile, log in from a laptop as well, so that you can do the hands-on with me. You don't need any setup. Sign up for the free account. It's you can just go to the labs and then take up a free account. You get 7 days free trial. So or you, if you have set up your own laptop, that's also good enough, and you can give it a try. All right, so I'm going to break down my talk into three parts, and I'm going to turn off my video after a point of time. Okay, so here we go. Let me just share my screen. All right, when the things get a little more serious, I'm going to turn off the video so on the screen. All right, so wonderful. So first thing I'm going to do is this is the agenda in general about the speaker. Then we do our introduction to machine learning, and then we understand the data, and then we go for the various steps of machine learning project, and then we will build our own first project and walk you through the various steps. All right, so be with me. It's not a session where you sit back and relax. It's the action time. It's the time where you take out your laptop and get coding. All right, so the idea is of Git Commit Show is that we do a lot of commits and show. So that's the time that this is the time that we should get started. Even if you have never done machine learning before, this is the first time, even then, this is a great chance. I'll just take exactly 1 hour from now, that's 4:06 till 5:06 to complete my talk. Maybe I'll spill over by a couple of minutes if there are more questions, but I'll focus more on questions and getting started with the, with hands-on. So all of you, if you are logged in from the laptop, is great, wonderful. But if you are logged in from a tablet or a phone, try to get a laptop as well. All right, and try to take the free account at Cloudflare Lab. So I'll just show you in case you're confused what we're going to do. And I'll introduce myself in a while. So you can go to Cloudflare Lab and just take the free account so that we can quickly get the lab set up. Otherwise, software setup might take you more time. So you can just go around and just start free lab, and that's about it. Okay, I've already taken the free labs. It's not giving me. Perfect. Now, the other link that we would be working on is bootml.com. This is a free software for all so that we can get started with machine learning. So this is a small tool that we created. It's immensely useful, and a lot of people use it to get started with their machine learning project. It just basically generates boilerplate code for yourself. All right. Now getting back to where we were. All right, so here we are. So that's about me. Feel free to send a LinkedIn request. And I started, I graduated from IIT Roorkee in 2002, and I have mostly worked on large-scale computing. And most of my career, I have worked on either large-scale computing or on the machine learning side. But I've been through around 17 years of experience. And my introduction to big data or large-scale computing was with D.E. Shaw in 2002. We had so big data that we could not download it, but we could ship it via a ship from the New York to Hyderabad in India. So that was a wonderful time when we realized that the electrons can be slower than the ship. All right? And that's the important part about data. So when the data grows bigger, the story changes, the way you look at things changes. All right? And then I founded a company, and then I worked with InMobi and Amazon. I enjoy explaining technologies to everyone. And that's the reason I'm doing this session. And that's the reason why I started CloudX Lab. So I enjoy teaching people the technology, as well as I enjoy tinkering around with the things. So feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn. If you have any questions, just feel free to reach out. All right, so this is about CloudX Lab. We are an AI-enabled edtech platform on machine learning and AI, and you can take a look at this. We are solving the problem by the way of gamified learning and knowledge graph. In gamified learning, we have all sorts of functionalities. You can take a look. The most important part is auto assessment engine. This keeps you hooked to getting hands-on. So almost for every tech tools in big data ecosystem and machine learning ecosystem, we have built this auto assessment environment so that you can not leave coding. You cannot leave coding at any point of time. That's the idea behind it. So it's basically opposite of what Facebook does to you. It's just opposite of that. All right, so we have a knowledge graph that we are going to release very soon, and this is where we lie in the ecosystem. We have most wonderful audience around the world. You can take a look at our code reviews, and we have got the top Udemy instructors endorsing us, and the top teams such as IBM research team is our learners. So most of the universities use CloudX Lab as of today. And so I'm going to not waste your time anymore with what we are and what we're not. I'm going to get straight to the machine learning process. Okay, so the free trial does ask for a payment. Somebody has asked a question that free trial is asking for payment. It's not asking for payment. It's just asking for credit card. It'll just deduct $1 and then refund it immediately. Okay, this is just to ensure that we have a KYC with our users. Otherwise, what happens is, since it's a full-fledged environment with all the tools, it can be used for spamming other people and so on. So that's why we just take, as a KYC, we just take a payment of $1 and refund it. I'm talking about the CloudX Labs free trial. All right, so what we're going to do is, I'm going to go really, really fast on this because I want to spend more time on hands-on. So if you are listening to this, stay tuned, pay attention, because I'm going to be extremely fast in this. If you have any questions, just pause me and ask. Okay. All right. So one thing that keeps people confused is the difference between normal programming and machine learning approach. So and before that, I want to define what it means by machine learning. So if you are around the computer and you can see the screen, this is what I'm going to talk about. So basically, here what we are doing is we are making the computer learn to play Mario. This is an example just to define what exactly is machine learning. Instead of defining in like 100 words, I'm going to show you a video of computer learning to play Mario. Even if you have no introduction to machine learning, this is something that is going to appeal to you. So here we go. So what we have done here is what the Tom Seven, his name is Tom Seven. What he did was he hooked a program to the Mario game. On one hand, we have Mario game, whereby it's running in the simulation, the emulation, we call it emulator. So Mario game is running inside an emulator, and the game, the software is learning to play Mario. So both are happening in the computer inside the software environment. So what program is going to do is program is going to press random keys and observe the screen. Okay. So this is how I want to define, I want to make you understand what is machine learning. So let's take a look. On the day zero, when the computer is learning to play Mario, it's pressing the keys randomly. You can see that the left bottom shows the keys being pressed. On the day zero, nothing happens. It dies of an old age, but it learns. On a couple of days later, it starts to move. The machine is learning, the software is learning how to play Mario. So it figures out that you can move and you can look a few frames in the future. But it's still really, really immature. Few more weeks, it is starting to play better than me. You can see that? It is learning to play better than me. So what's happening is the software is playing game over and over again and observing in what circumstances it should do. Nobody taught the program what is gravity, what is collision, what is color. Nobody has taught the program. All we are doing is feeding the screen and feeding the keys. Like in this screen, it's basically pressing the keys like mad and figuring out like what works out, what doesn't work out. Okay. Few more weeks, what you're going to see is just amazing. It's just amazing what you're going to see. After a few more weeks, it's playing far better than me. And you're going to see the software playing a trick, exploiting a game. You see that? How did it do that? Did you see that? So when a Goomba is falling, it figured out a bug in Mario game, which we never knew. So this is the amazing part about machine learning. It figures out a lot of things by itself by looking at data over and over again. You see that? What was that? I have no clue how did he do that. So he hooked it to many other programs, and some of the programs it could not win. So it kept on pausing. It kept on pausing when it could not win, because that was the only way it could retain the score. That was the only way it could retain the score. And that's a sign of intelligence. It's a sign of intelligence. Our siblings spoiled the game when they were about to lose. In the same way, the software, when it was playing some games and there was no way to win the game, it kept pausing the game, because that was the only way to stay the winner. So this was machine learning. The machine learned by itself without you teaching it anything. Machine learned everything by itself. So this is an example of machine learning. So, and I find that a lot of us are very confused about what exactly is machine learning. Now I'm going to move ahead and go a little faster. So if you are, all right, if you're not listening type person, you may be able to pay a little bit more attention, because I'm going to be extremely fast. And because I have a lot of things to talk about and I have just 1 hour. All right. So the next thing I want to explain to you is what is typical machine learning process. Typical machine learning process is, right? So there's incoming mail. Let's take an example of incoming mail. As part of the project, we have to design a spam filter. So we have an incoming mail, and the spam filter is supposed to put it into inbox or put it in spam, right? That's the spam filter. Question is, how do you build a spam filter? Using the traditional approach, what we do is we write the rules by ourselves. When the subject is like this, then mark it as spam. When its subject is not like that, then mark it as put it to inbox. So we write these rules. We write these rules in the traditional approach. The traditional way of working was we study the problem and we write the rules. But with the traditional approach, we keep on writing these rules. The code becomes bigger and bigger. And after a point of time, it becomes unmanageable. And there are so many other problems with the traditional approach. With the ML approach, with the machine learning approach, what we do is we study the problem, we hook it to the ML algorithm, and then we evaluate the solution, and then we launch, right? So here, what we do is we study the problem, and then what we do is we let ML algorithm figure out the possible solutions by the way of learning from the data. The algorithm is learning from the data, and this is what we call it sometimes model. Okay. So instead of we studying the problem in detail and coming up with the rules, we study the basics of it and figure out how we can hook the data to the algorithm so that it can come up with the model or the rules. And then if it's performing great, we launch. All right. So general thumb rule is we have data, we feed it to algorithm, we get the model. And once we have the model, we can do the inference or prediction on the live data. So this is basically the core about machine learning. So in machine learning, we let the computer figure out the rules instead of we writing the rules. Just like instead of telling a program that when you see the Goomba, jump like that, move like this, and so on, instead of doing that, we kept on feeding the data to the algorithm and told the algorithm that this is the expected output and figure it out how to reach there. That's exactly the machine learning process. And so when we are, we hear it all the time that, hey, we have got the data, we have to feed it machine, but there is a catch. We have to translate our data in the form of features, labels, and instances. Okay, three things. Features, labels, and instances. That's the most important part. Any machine learning problem, if you want to hook it to the ML algorithm, you need to come up with features, labels, and instances. All right? So that's what we are going to talk about next. So imagine the email solution. You are supposed to come up with a model which can figure out whether something is a spam or not a spam, right? So in this case, these are the features. The features are the characteristics of each of the observations, right? So if we present our data in the form of tables, the rows are going to be the instances. These are going to be the observations that if the subject is this, sender is this, it's a spam. Otherwise, it's not a spam. Okay. So these are the observations. Each observation has characteristics. We call them features, and each observation has the label. Notice that some problems don't have the labels. We call them unsupervised problems. All right. In those cases, the problem statement is not like that come up with a label or predict something. Problem statement is like just look at the data and give some clustering, do some kind of clustering. So that's about unsupervised. So here, what we have to do is take any problem, convert it into a tabular form, mark the labels, mark the features, and mark the instances. Each row is supposed to be the instances. These are going to be features, and so on. All right. The attributes of any observation, like in case we are going to predict whether some fruit is an apple or something else, the attributes could be color, size, weight, and taste, or maybe the photo. All right. The label is the prediction that we are looking for. The instances are basically each observation. Each photo that we want to predict an object in is an observation or instance. All right, so we're going to focus more on supervised machine learning. In the supervised machine learning, we basically predict a label, predict something, all right, and or predict a value. So that's what we're going to do. Like here, given a photo, we are predicting whether a photo contains a sheep, horse, frog, dog, deer, or something, or multiple of those. Or given a data set, we have to predict whether an email is a ham or a spam. Or given a photo of handwritten character, we have to predict that what is written in that. So that's also a supervised machine learning problem, and we call that classification. Regression is where we have to predict the actual value instead of a class. Okay, so that's called regression. And in unsupervised learning, there are other challenges. So I'm going to move ahead from here, because this will this is going to take a lot of time. I just realized that 1 hour is not sufficient for this. I'm going to move ahead a little bit. Okay, move ahead a little bit. All right, so again, back to the machine learning process. We have the data on our hand. So what we do is we feed this data to the algorithm. An algorithm comes with the model. Model is like mental model, right? The way you have a mental model of predicting that this is a person and this is an animal. Just like that, a computer also builds a model, right? Similarly, we are basically a walking bundle of model. Bundle of models, you can say, if not one. Okay, so in the same way, what we do is we feed the data to the algorithm. Algorithm comes up with these this model, which we call them weights. I can go on and on for this, but I'll move ahead. So this is something that we need to understand. First of all, whenever you are faced with a problem, first thing you have to decide is it supervised learning, machine learning, or unsupervised? If the problem statement is like, given this, we have to predict this, right? And we have a training data available to predict that. We call that supervised. So first of all, we have to figure out whether it's supervised or unsupervised, right? And then what we have to do is we have to figure out what are the instances and what are the attributes. What are the instances and what are the attributes? All right. So here, what you see is this data that you see is going to be converted into columns and rows and so on. Okay. The next step is we break the data set into two parts, training and test. Just like if somebody comes to you and tells you that, hey, I know the future, I can tell you your future. So what do? You ask them. Coming up with a model, we are going to test it first. We're going to test it on the past before the model starts predicting the future. Therefore, whatever historical data we have, we split it into two parts. One part for the training, other part for the testing. One part for the training and other part for the testing. And that's a very, very standard process. So on this part, we are going to train a model. We're going to feed this data to the algorithm so that it can generate the model. And on this part, we will measure the performance of the newly created model. We'll see whether it's doing good or not. Right? So generally, if we break it down into 80-20. So this is what we're going to do. And let's just get started with the end-to-end project. So this was the minimal amount of introduction I could plan. Okay, let's just get started with the hands-on project. All right. Great. Any questions so far? I have gone a little too fast introducing the basic terms. No questions? Let me just take a look at the Twitch video in case there is a question.
So there is try to sign up a free trial on CloudX Lab. So it's okay. Not working. Is there any coupon code or something?
Why it's not working?
When there is a payment screen.
I explained that the payment screen.
Okay. So the payment pay- through that.
Yeah. So what you have to do is.
Yeah, sure.
I'll just show you. Okay. So actually the challenge is that we don't mind giving it for free. The challenge is that since it's a full environment, full-fledged environment where there is everything, we are giving the free trial for everybody. So we are afraid that it might be abused. Therefore, we want to avoid it. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open it in incognito. All right. So So I'll just say start free trial. Okay, sign up with Google. Okay, and I'm not sure if I have any account left. Okay, so we can go with say Sandeep. Of Sandeep, I think this will work, right? Sandeep, S-A-N-D-E-E-P dot Gmail. I couldn't find your account. Okay, so, all right. I think it is also taken already. I have already taken all the trials. Okay, so let me try some accounts. Okay, or maybe I can just delete some of the trial things. Okay, just give me a second and I'll be able to demonstrate to you in a minute, because I don't have my own. Okay. So, all right. All right, give me a moment. All right, so all right, in the meantime, actually my whole accounts are done and I need to figure out how to do the payments. Okay, let me just try once more if I can avoid that. Okay, so I'm going to delete this account. Probably that will work. Okay, let's just try it out. I paused my screen sharing so that I can log into the backend. So what exactly error are you facing, Pradeep, for KYC?
No, just wanted to have a guide how to do that.
Okay, okay. Actually, I don't have a login which is not used. So I'll just try with the other account.
I can do one thing. I can share my screen.
Okay, okay. That's also good. Let me just try once more. Okay, just give me a moment. Yeah, try it. Okay, so let me. Should I share for a moment? Let me just give it a shot. Okay.
Sure.
So, do you see it here? Okay, so let me also go here. Just a moment. I'm just trying to find out one of my accounts, like either Office one or something, the one that doesn't have already taken up the sign up, already taken up the KYC. All right, just give me a moment. I'm almost done. All right. So, wow. Okay. No, I think you should guide it, because it's deleting a lot of information if I'm deleting my account. Okay.
This is the payment when you, sorry, this is the account. When you click start free trial,
yeah.
So you sign up there with your Gmail account. Mine is pradeep@invitelabs.com.
Just put some credit card. Yeah, you know, you have to put a proper credit card. Okay.
Okay, that's the contact number. And so put your contact number here and.
Okay, just give me a moment. If you need my credit card, you can use that.
Then you can use this credit card here. Right?
Yeah. Is this data?
And put your, awesome. So I think we can give a couple of minutes for people to do this.
Okay. So this is actually free. Entire thing is free for 7 days, which is actually pretty costly for us. But we run it for free because people across the globe, they want to check before what we do. And most of the people who are running their classes, the weekday classes, they use it for free across the globe. Okay. It's a full 7 day, meaning 7 into 24 hours into 3,600 seconds. Okay. 3,600 seconds. Perfect. Now, I hope everybody is clear. So in case you are a student, if you are a student, as in the university students, you get 15 days or a month free, and that too without the credit card. You have to use the college institution's ID. Okay.
Great.
Now,
so I'm almost done.
Okay. All right. So I'm going back to this one. All right. So even if you did not follow through chapter so far, don't worry, don't leave. It's going to be, you know, very hands-on as we go ahead. All right. Okay. All right, so this is about it.
Almost done with the payment.
Okay. Okay. If you're okay, you can share the screen and this can also take the inspiration from that. And then okay. It's good that you are. It's good that
I'm here.
Okay. Just go to my lab, it should work.
Awesome.
Okay. Yeah, it's set up, so you can try. You can just click on Jupyter Notebook and just check, take a look at your account. There's a Jupyter button on the right side. You can see Web Console Jupyter. Yeah. So, all right. So that's the invite. You just copy paste the password from there, the login password. Yeah.
Okay.
And the login is also there. So you have to copy the login. Yeah, so Pradeep 2263 is your login and the password is there. Perfect. Okay, so you can save the password so that it doesn't bother you again. Okay, so here you go. And this is where your notebooks will be created and you can utilize this. Okay, these are the default notebooks. You don't have to touch them right now. We'll talk about them when we go into more details. Okay, so also you can click go up go back to my lab, CloudX lab, my lab. Yeah, no, the previous tab. Yeah. So there you have the my resources. There are lots of resources to learn. Like my courses is there, and the learn is there. So this will get you. Quickly started with the entire machine learning process. Okay, so you have Linux Basics, Scala, MapReduce Programming, Python, as well as Python for Data Science, all available in your My Courses. All of this is something that we want people to learn and quickly started with the programming. No matter what is your background, no matter which vertical do you come from, this is going to be very, very useful to you. This is something, programming is something that would be needed and is needed in almost every vertical, whether you are a generalist, whether you are a biologist, whether you are working in a cement company or work anywhere, the programming is something that you got to learn. Okay. And this is the place where you can get started quickly. The only downside with our entire process is that since we provide the entire environment, it takes a bit of time to just sign up. And this place gives you the entire feeling. You can create do Git commits and do all kinds of things from within the environment. It gives you the entire Linux environment for yourself. All right. So that's about what we were trying to set up. Now moving ahead, let me share my screen. And so I'm going to walk you through the presentation as well as do the hands-on as we walk through it. Okay. So first thing is, let's just take a project for getting started. One of the easiest project as well as complex project is predicting the housing prices in California. So what we're going to do is we're going to learn how would we predict the pricing in an area in California. So we are given this data. We're given this data whereby we have longitude, latitude, and the house, the age of the house and the total rooms in that area. So each row, what you see is each row is representing a small district, a small sector, you can say, small area in California. And that areas, that area has these many rooms, these many bedrooms. This is the population. This is the household. And this is the median income. This is the median house value. And whether the houses, whether the area is near to the ocean or not. Okay. So what we have to do as part of this is we have to predict the median house value. We have to predict the median house value given all of the other parameters. We will be in a real scenario, we will be given all other attributes like at this location, if the house age is this much and the total rooms are this much and the total bedrooms are this much, what will be the median house value? Okay, that's what we got to predict. Now, at what price should we sell the house? Okay, so this is what we need to predict. Okay, so this is the data and these are the steps that we are going to follow. Okay, so first we look at the bigger picture. Bigger picture as in you ask like, where is my work going to get used? You try to understand what exactly is the problem we are trying to solve. We select a performance measure, meaning how would we measure that our model is working perfectly good? If we have come up with a model which can predict the house prices, then what should be the performance on which we are judging it? We are measuring the performance of our model. All right, check this assumptions. What are the assumptions we are making? So, and the next thing is that understand where is your component being used, going to be used in the real scenario. So you come to know that whatever component that you build to predict the house pricing, you're going to use it in some pipeline. In some pipeline. And also understand what is the current solution's performance. So you find out how much is the accuracy or how much is the error in the current solution. And you find out that, okay, right now, when people, the people who are into real estate, then they predict the house prices, their error is on an average 15%. So can we bring down 15% to something? That would be our objective. All right. So is it supervised machine learning or unsupervised? It is supervised, right? Now, let me just get started. Probably this will be something that those who have logged in into CloudX Lab, This is going to be quite useful to you. Just click on give it a shot. Okay. Wait for a moment. It is going to load the wizard. So click on, or you can just use this one. This one. Okay. Let me see if I can open the notes. All right, so you can simply go here. All right, bootml.com. Okay, this redirects to CloudX Lab, this one. Okay. All right, so bootml.com is something that where you have to go. Now, what is bootml.com? It's basically something, I mean, instead of just presenting what I'm saying, doing right now, we're going to do it by the side. Okay. And this tool is going to generate the entire code so that you don't have to type the code or follow exactly like character by character. Right. So what you're going to do is we're going to follow this tool. It's going to help you out in understanding what does it mean by machine learning to you. All right. So here we go. So we are going to review an existing project, which is housing in California, the price of the housing in the California. And then we click on next. Now, it is asking what type of project it is. Is it supervised or unsupervised? So we pick up supervised. What is supervised? In the supervised, we have to predict some value for which we have the historical information available. Like if we have emails with marked as spam or not spam historically, then it's a supervised machine learning problem because we have the history of labels. We have history of spams. As well as, let's say we have a historical data of housing prices. So we have the labels and we need to predict those values. So it is a supervised machine learning problem. Okay. So this is a supervised machine learning problem. Now, is it a classification or regression? It is a regression. Why? What is it that we are trying to predict? The housing value. It is not a class that we are trying to predict. We're not trying to predict male or female. We are not trying to predict one of the options. Instead, it is like subjective question, filling the blanks. Had it been like objective question, we would use a classification. Here, it is a regression problem. Okay, so the next step is we select the model performance, right? Now, model performance measure is, in case of regression, it is mean squared error. Meaning, what we are going to do is we are going to compare the predicted value against the actual value by subtracting and squaring and then summing all the errors together. That is the measure of performance. Mean squared error is, let's say we give it a house and let it predict a value. Then we give it another house, let it predict a value. We compare it against the actual value and then we square it and sum it. That's the total error. Why do we square and sum it? Because if we just sum it, the negative error will cancel the positive error, right? That would be a disaster. So what we do is we choose something called mean squared error. Okay. So understand what is a performance measure. Understand what is mean squared error, what is precision recall and F1. Precision recall or classification, but since it's a regression, generally people use mean squared error. There are quite a few other performance measures. Generally, in case of regression, people use mean squared error. Now, when you got a data set, you got to upload the data. We have already uploaded the data, so we are not going to just use We're just not going to upload it fresh one. Instead, just we use it from the repository. So we have created this existing repository model in the BootML so that you don't have to keep uploading the data. So, but you're free to upload the data in case of for which the data is not in the cloud app. You can just click on upload and it'll let you upload. Now, here we are selecting this data file and so on. Now is the important part. So our data looks like this. This is our data. Okay. You see that? So here, these are the various columns. So what are the features? Features are the columns. Instances are these rows. Each instance is the house pricing along with all characteristics for a district, not for the each house. Okay. That's why you see this median age and so on. All right. So these are the all columns that you see here. Okay. These are all columns in the data that we want to use. So do you think we should discard some of the columns? In some cases, we do, right? Like, for example, there's an ID column, unique identifier column, right? Generally, we discard those because they are not adding any value to prediction, right? They are unnecessarily making it remember, like instead of you remembering the word and meaning, you are remembering, okay, what is the position of the word in the dictionary, right? That is wrong. So we generally remove those kind of columns. So right now we don't have to remove any of the columns. Okay, we're moving ahead. Next thing is we need to mark what is a feature out of all the columns, what are the features and what are the labels. So our objective of this exercise is that when we have a trained model, when we have a perfectly trained model, the model should be able to predict a housing value, right? Therefore, that is a label and rest of it are the features. Now the very, very important part. As I told you, that this data set need to be split into two parts. training, and test. And generally, test is 20% and training is 80%. So we are going to train our model on 80% data and test it on remaining 20%. All right. And then we are going to just put a random seed. We'll not talk about this right now. We'll talk about, you can go over this. This is not that significant. This is basically whenever we do the randomization, on what basis we do the randomization, that is the random seed. Okay. Now, there are a few more nitty-gritties, like using the stratified sampling. So in case your data has very important characteristics on a certain column, you should, instead of randomly sampling, you should create strata out of your data and sample it. What is strata? Like, in case you want voting, from all stratas of the society. Some strata should not be ignored. Therefore, what you do is, for a particular characteristic, we make the stratas and break the data. Well, when we are picking the training set or test set, we pick the training or test from the representation of all kinds of stratas from the data set should be there in training as well as test. That's why we use the stratified sampling. Right now, I'm going to skip the stratified sampling and move ahead. Okay. All right. So this is our data set here. Now moving ahead. And all right, you can we generally have to visualize the data set. So you can select these columns. It is not going to reflect right away. It's just going to generate the code that can plot the charts. Okay, so let it plot the way it is. Also, we want to see the correlation between the data set. So let's just see how the correlation looks like. And the scatter matrix is also quite useful to understand the correlation between input and output. So this way we can figure out which columns are important and so on. Though this is just for, we call it something called visual analytics, or you can say the general analytics. So to understand our data a little bit more, we can use these. But it's not really required. So this is your actual data, and we can plot it the way you want. All right, so moving ahead here. Now, when we have data set, some of the columns or some of the rows might have the missing values. In that case, what we do is we fix the missing values by generally taking the mean of all of the column. Okay, this way we'll fix the missing values with the mean. Okay, it's basically filling in the missing values. All right, the other thing is we need to break down our data set into categorical and numerical fields. What are categorical fields? The categorical fields are like options, like multiple choice values, like drop downs. In our data set, it's not necessary that all the data is upfront in the form of numbers, right? In the form of decimal numbers. Some of the columns could be like category, whether it's near C or away from C, all right? Or it could be one of the columns could be, say, let's say urban or rural. So that's basically categorical numbers. Right now, these are the numerical fields, and there is only one categorical fields. Okay, it's going to convert the categorical fields into numbers by using a technique called one-hot encoding. We can go over the details of one-hot encoding at some other time. All it does is break down one column into multiple columns such that it basically puts a tick mark 0 and 1. All right, so it converts the categories into one hot encoding structure. Now, the other thing is, whenever we are feeding the data to algorithm, we should normalize or scale the data. We should scale the data such that all values are between 0 and 1. All values are between 0 and 1. Most of the algorithms work really good when you scale them. So let's scale them. Let all of these be scaled on min-max, and or maybe the standardization, but let it be this way for now. Okay, so right now we are, for all numbers, we are scaling them to min-max. Okay, moving ahead. The next step is, which algorithms do you want to try? Right now we have only put 3, but there are like 100 algorithms out there. So we're just going to let the system compare which algorithm is doing better. Okay, so this is done by comparison of various algorithms is done by a technique called cross-folding. All it does is take your training set, test an algorithm, see the performance, and then try all of the models, all of these algorithms or the models to do the prediction and observe their performance. All right, so here let's just select all of these algorithms, and to compare between them, it's going to further improve these. What it's going to do is, in the 11th step, what it's going to do is, first, it's going to find out what are those algorithms that are performing great. Okay, the next thing it's going to do is, it's going to perform a tuning further, that to improve the performance of this algorithm, what are those parameters that we need to tweak? For that, we are going to use grid search. All of this is basically a brute force approach, meaning that first it's going to try out all the algorithms and try to train all of them. It's like having a student in the class and let them perform, let them learn from the data and then see their performance, whichever is performing first. They go in the final round and then we do a specialized training, or you can say fine tuning of the best performer with the grid search. That's what we're going to do here. All right, moving ahead. So now is the D-Day, the last step, where we generate the notebook. So now the notebook has been generated. Let's just open the notebook and walk through what's going on there. What is a notebook? Those who are new to Jupyter Notebook, notice that in Jupyter Notebook, there are two kinds of cells. One is basically a place where you write the code, and other is the output of the code. All right. This is basically the documentation part. So you can just change the type to Markdown. So it is a Markdown. Okay. So this is the end result. This is how your machine learning project looks like. So BootML has generated this entire project based on the selection we have done. If you have any other problem that you want to, you can just use BootML right away. Instead of selecting an existing project, you can create your own fresh new project. It's not going to be very hard. It's going to be very straightforward. All you need to do is frame your data, frame your problem into the tabular form, convert your data set into tabular form, and then upload the data onto the CloudX Lab and let it generate the notebook for you. In this notebook, this is the documentation it has generated for you. This is the import and you know, the usual how to load your data. So here, let's run it. So it has run the data set. Also, we can take a look at the data set by using the head. Okay, it has generated all those things that you might require while you poke around the data set. So you can see that it has loaded the data set into this data frame. Okay. So this, we are using the Pandas. Pandas is a utility just like SQL manipulates the database tables. Using Pandas, we can manipulate the read-only data from files. Like here, we have housing.csv. We can manipulate this data, like adding more columns and so on. So that's the use case of Pandas. Pandas is a library in Python. Okay. So here we go. And this is the head of like first few rows of our data set. Now, the next step is we understand what's going on with the dataset. So you can see it has given us these all code to understand what is about the dataset. So you can see for each column, it is giving us the information like how many values are there and whether they are null or not. All right, then further, we can find out the various categories on each of the categorical variables. Have only one categorical variable, that is ocean proximity. That's a non-numerical value. So it is showing us that in ocean proximity, these are the various values, meaning total number of times island has occurred is 5 and so on, right? Now moving ahead, and this is the head of the, again, data set, same thing which we have done above. We can also use the describe. Describe is a wonderful function from Pandas. It tells us the information about every column. So longitude, latitude, these are the values. I'm not sure if we call it longitude or longitude, but I'm going to stick with longitude. Okay. And here, latitude is, these are the values of latitude. Moving ahead. So this shows us the variance and how our data is distributed in each column. Okay. Next is we plot the histogram. Okay. Against every feature, against every column, it is generating the histogram. It shows that the behavior about each column. You can see that. So this is basically part of the visual analytics. It helps you understand how your data is spread. On y-axis is the number of instances. On x-axis is the value. If you want to, let's say, understand the price of a house in a city, the best way is plotting the histogram. Or if you want to see how the price varies across the time, you can again put the pricing on y-axis. Generate the histogram. All right. Now moving ahead. So here we're going to split the data set. So we have split the data set into training and test. And then we're going to keep a copy of it so that we don't bother the original data set. And then we are plotting it just to visualize what's going on. Let's just forget about this part and move ahead. There are many ways you can plot this. Okay. Right now, next very important part is correlation metrics. So this is correlation metrics. So good news is that you don't really memorize any of this. Okay. These are the classic standard step which you do in any machine learning project, and BootML has generated the entire notebook for you. Okay. Then also scatter metrics is another very useful way to understand the data set. All right. So here it's basically generating that scatter metrics, and it is going to show you how the charts look like, as in how the data is varying in each cell. Okay. Let's just move ahead, and instead of worrying about this, it is going to take a bit of time to, you can see it is still running. When you see an asterisk here, that means it is still running. Okay. So in case you guys are trying to finish the BootML, this would be a good time to just finish it. Just press next, and only in couple of, places like algorithm selection, where you have to make some choices. Otherwise, it'll just do everything for you. Okay. So there you don't have to touch anything. There you don't have to touch anything. There you don't have to touch anything. And you don't have to discard. So only at the 11th page, you have to make some changes. Okay? All right. So I think it is showing how the data is varying in each column against every variable. All right, so moving ahead. Now, we are going to prepare the data for machine learning algorithms. Okay, so we're going to basically fill in the value with the imputer. Okay, this is the important part. So let me just run it, doesn't matter. Okay, so here we're basically handling the missing data sets. Also, we are creating a new data set without the ocean proximity, because we don't want that in the data set where we are scaling it. And then here we are converting the ocean proximity, which was a categorical field, which was a drop down, into the numeric one. All right, so moving ahead, this categorical encoder is something extra that we have done here. Now is the time. So here we are creating the pipeline of entire thing, whatever we are doing, like selection of attributes, and then converting the drop down into a numerical value. That's categorical encoder that we've done here. Then we are scaling the features as we discussed. And then this is where the pipeline of selecting the field, fixing the missing values and scaling the values. This is the pipeline for that. And for categorical variables, we first do the min max and then join the category. Okay, join the concatenate the categorical variables. Okay, now moving ahead, here is the important part. Okay, so we can skip this. All right, so this is just to check if our prepared data set is good or not. Now, this is a function that we're defining to display the scores. This display underscore scores is going to display the scores. Oh, let me just increase the font size in case the screen is not clear enough. All right, so this is the, also we can just do a view full screen. Yeah, this looks far better. Now, this is display score. Display scores basically is going to display the scores of each algorithm. Now is the time that we start training the model. Notice that actual work of machine learning is in these three lines, right? Whereby we are creating an instance of an algorithm, like linear regression is one of the algorithm or models we call it. With this, all we need to do is we have to call a method called fit. And we have to pass this method called, we have to pass the data set changing values and converting the categorical value into something. And this is where we are doing the training. This is the training part. So it has done the training very quickly. Here we are calculating the error. This much is the error that linear regression is giving. Now let's try the score of linear regression by trying out multiple parts of the training data set by using something called cross validation. In cross validation, we take the training data set, we basically train on some part of the training and then test it on some part and do it over and over. Okay, that's called k-fold cross validation. So if you have 100 records in training set, what we do is we train on 90 and test on 10, right? That's what it is. Now moving ahead, and here we're just checking it out. Next one is decision tree. Decision tree is also another algorithm which learns from the data and can do the predictions. So decision tree is another model. So here we are training decision tree. You don't need to understand any of these variables. You can just consider it that these are some characteristics of the model that you don't know about. It's completely okay not to understand it. All right. When you go deep dive, then you can understand it. Now, it has memorized the entire thing. It has kind of memorized because it's giving zero error on the same data set on which we trained. So it basically memorized the textbook. That's why it's giving zero error. Now, moving ahead, so further, we basically take the linear decision tree regressor again, and basically we are observing the scores. All right? Now, moving ahead, next algorithm that you want to try is the random forest. So we have tried the linear regression. We have tried the decision tree. We are trying the random forest regression. Okay, so this is going to take some time. All right, so this is another algorithm that learns, which is based on decision trees, and it's an ensemble one. So I can go into more details probably some other time. Now here what you see is, it's basically giving this kind of error, 21,200. And what was the error in case of the linear regression? It was 68,000. So which one is better? The 21,000 is better, right? 21,000 is better. That means the random forest regressor is far better than that. Okay. Now, We try this algorithm using cross-validation and observe the overall error. All right, let it run. It's going to try the model 10 times, and each 10 times is going to train on 90% data, and then on remaining 10% data is going to test it out. So you can see that the mean error is 51,000. All right, that sounds more reasonable. Now the next step is to fine tune. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about what are these variables. Doesn't matter. We are just taking all kinds of permutations of all the variables and we are trying it out. And that's what we call it, the grid search. We're going to try all permutations of various parameters so that we can further improve the random forest, because random forest was the one which was giving the best results. Okay? I think it's going to take a long, long time. And once we are done, we can check which are the parameters which matter the most. We can find out which is the best estimator, or you can say best model, and then we can print the results. Afterwards, we can further show the importances of the features based on the model. So this is how you train your first model. This is how you train the first model. And basically, the end outcome of this is, you know what is the end outcome? End outcome is this model that you trained it here. Okay, the best estimator that you have trained it here, that is the end outcome. You can save it somewhere and then you can reuse it in the production. Okay, so this is the classic machine learning project. And this is something I urge every developer to learn, because almost every engineering field today is moving to machine learning. So whether you are a front end or a back end or architect, or you are, even if you are not from machine learning side, you must learn machine learning, because what we are doing here is something very close to the understanding of the human mind as well. All right. So that's pretty much, let it go on for some time. It's going to take some time to finish it. And that's pretty much which I want you to cover. If you have any questions, I'm keeping like 10 minutes for the questions. So you can ask me the questions.
Got it. Thanks a lot, Sandeep, for this wonderful talk. So yes, I was going through everything. And as I have seen, what I understood from everything is how the complete process of a machine learning project is going to be. As we started with some data set, yeah, and then we prepare that data by discarding some irrelevant fields, then adding some features and labels, splitting the data, then visualizing the data. And then we did some categorical field selection. Yeah. Then we did some feature scaling for reducing the error, right?
Yeah.
And then we went on to algorithm selection.
Yeah.
And then finally, there is notebook. So one thing, I don't have any idea what is exactly notebook.
Okay.
Then second thing is...
So notebook is a place where you type the code. Okay, so notebook is a very, very, you can say that this is a script. This is a script of your code. So it has code, and then when you run it by pressing shift enter, you can run it, or you can just select the cell and run it. So it's basically the way you did the things on the console, where you type the code and it gives you the output. It's exactly the same. So you write your code, press shift enter, it gives you the output.
Got it. So is it an open source project?
Yes, yes. A notebook is a wonderful, the whole world is going to, so it's an urge to all of you that in case you are in machine learning, just, use Jupyter and make your most of the work around Jupyter.
Got okay? it. Understood. So meanwhile, to the audience, if you have any questions, you can ask them in the chat. And I have some questions, and hopefully, probably most of us will have similar kind of questions. So I will ask on behalf of the audience. One thing I did not understand is this categorical field selection.
Okay. Okay.
So what do you mean by that, and what is the purpose of this step?
Okay. Do you mind turning on your video? I can just say.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Okay. Yep. All right. So wonderful question. Wonderful question. So I'm going to walk you through a very simple example. And probably that'll help you out. Okay. So do I have pre-built slides for the same thing? Probably I do. Let me just walk you through. Okay. All right. So this is what, there's a lot of slides. Okay. Never mind. So I'm going to just draw it and explain what it means by, okay, so can I just share a whiteboard? All right, let me just share the whiteboard. I hope it is clear to all of you. All right, so here we go. The whiteboard looks like this. And can you see my screen? And Yeah. So imagine that you have a data set, right? And one of the characteristics of the data set is gender. Okay? Gender and salary. Imagine that you're predicting the salary based on the gender and other characteristics. So gender will be like male, female, and others. Okay? Male, female, and others. And now we have like these three genders. Now model, when we are feeding this to algorithm wants it to be 0 or 1 or some number, right? So what we do is we convert it into this. We convert it into this format. My handwriting might look really ugly, but if you listen to me while I'm talking. So the way we do is this gender column, instead of male, female, what we do is we convert it into gender underscore male, right? Gender underscore female and gender underscore others. And then salary remains there. So basically, the salary the salary column remains as such. Okay, salary, S-A-L. Now, here, what we do is instead of writing MFO, we write 1, 0, 0, because the first row was male, correct? So we in that column, we put 1. Then if the gender is female, we put, right, in that column, if you put like 1, because third middle row, the third row, this first row, the second row, third row, the third row, second row was female. So we put 1 here, rest is 0. And in case gender is others, we put 1 here and 0. So we converted one column into three columns in the data set. Now it became numbers, right? 1010, right? And this way we can convert any categorical type of data set, type of column or the feature into a number. Did it make sense? Yeah.
So you mean having a data which is described in normal language that we speak, convert yes. that into 1010 kind of yes. format.
Yes, yes.
Got it.
Okay.
I have more question about algorithm selection. Okay. So can we have a brief about that or will it be better to
go
somewhere else? Yeah.
I can just summarize it very quickly. So if you have...
No, how to go about it? I don't know what is linear regression. I don't know what is random forest.
Okay. So good news is that even if you don't know what is linear regression or random forest, if you just know that linear regression is one of the algorithms, okay? So quickly, linear regression, SVM, random forest, decision tree, and neural network. These are algorithms. And you have data, you feed the data to these algorithms, they generate the model, you take the model and start doing the prediction. So that's about it. So even if you don't know anything about them, it's completely okay. Just like a good manager doesn't have to really get down into every nitty-gritties, you can observe that this algorithm is giving this much accuracy, this algorithm is giving this much accuracy, so you pick the one that's giving good accuracy. And that's what we did. We basically observed which one is giving less error. We picked that one. Or if you are stuck in a scenario where you have two algorithms, and both of them are doing pretty good, okay? What do you do in those cases? My answer is use both of them, just like a team. So you ask both of them, whenever you are about to do a prediction, you ask both of the algorithms, say, ask linear regression that what is the value? And ask the second one what is the value and give the output as the average of two. Okay? So this way, you can utilize like a teamwork. Okay? So in case you have more than one algorithm that are working perfectly fine, you take both of them and ensemble them. We call it ensemble learning or ensemble learning.
Got it. So to get... you don't need to know specifics of algorithms.
Yes, that's right.
Got it. Understood. So now that we have a mental model, how to go about a machine learning project, what next, where to what is next? What is it that we can do?
All right. So, if you want to dive deep, one is that you want to dive deep into each algorithm and understand how exactly it's working. Second is looking at existing algorithm, you want to improve the performance, or you may want to compete on Kaggle or other open source places, right? That could be another thing. The third thing could be that you look at a problem and you see that, oh, this is a good place where we can provide create a good mobile app. Like, for example, in face recognition or in anything like agriculture and so on. If you get a cool idea that, okay, this is the data that we have in agriculture and we can do the predictions. So you don't have to right away just start learning machine learning. Instead, build a cool app. And then once you get more and more data, you can keep on improving the performance of your model. So there are many things that you could do as a profession. Either you can build a new app, you can compete at Kaggle, or if you want to learn more or deep dive into this, just follow a couple of books. The one that I really follow is Hands-On with Machine Learning and Deep Learning by Aureline. And the second one is the Deep Learning by Yoshio Benji. There is a very popular book. And then you can also come over to our YouTube channel. We have lots and lots of, almost the entire deep learning, machine learning course is over there on our website also. So you can deep dive into machine learning, come over to the website on CloudX Lab, in case you want to deep dive into the entire thing. Hey, yeah, you're muted.
Sorry. Yeah. So we will just note it down and share it with everyone. This might be a little fast to note down for everyone.
Yeah.
So we have one more question and okay. So we are waiting for questions. Meanwhile, what did you, how this feature scaling works? I don't completely understand it. What I have right now, a mental model is that what you mean by feature scaling is having more data for a particular feature. Is it so or something else?
Okay. I'll just describe you. Probably I'll just share my, where's my book? Yeah. So here we are. And again, let me just take the simple example. Okay. How can I clear everything? Okay, so here we are, and I'm going to just draw another example. So imagine that one of the columns, this is, let's say, column called latitude, and this is a column called, let's say, area, okay, area, or this is a column, some other column, okay, called, let's say, percentage population, okay. This one goes from 0 to 100, right? Maximum will go to 0 to 100, maximum, right? This one area goes to, let's say, 100 to a million, right? Somewhere in the midway. Latitude also ranges like from negative 5 to, let's say, positive 500, something like that. So the point is that these values are varying a lot, right? These values are varying a lot. So you got to scale them. You got to scale them. Okay. You got to scale them because the algorithms, most of the algorithms work on a principle, on gradient descent. We can go into more details later. Most of the algorithms don't like the columns, which are just too varying. So let's say this one is varying from 100 to a million. And this one is, so most of the algorithms don't like it. So what you do is the minimum value, you scale it to zero, maximum value, you pull it to one, and everything in between. Okay? So you basically, just like normalizing in your exams, when you have to do the grades from, 0 to 10, right? You basically normalize, right? Standardize or normalize. And that's what we do, so that we pull the num marks, everything into the same scale, 0 to 1. Got it? Again, you're muted, so does it make sense? Feel free to ask. I would love to explain.
Okay, cool. So we have one more question coming in.
Yeah.
That is about the last point we were discussing,
mm-hmm.
Where we represented the data with zeros and ones.
Yeah.
So the question is asked by Mohit Garg, why can't we just represent male, female, and other that you gender represented as mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3 instead of separating them in 3 columns?
Good question. My question is, let's say the model can, if model starts predicting 1.5, what will you do? Right? It doesn't make sense, right? So what happens is, if there's a person, right? If basically the 1.5 wouldn't make any sense. Therefore, in such cases, it's a very fine, hard question to answer, okay? That whether a particular variable is a categorical variable or numerical variable, right? So in case, let's say we talk about temperature. The temperature is 0, 1, 2, 3. High, very high, low, very, very low, right? In that case, we can convert it into 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's called ordered categorical variables or ordinal categorical variables. In that case, we can do. But when things are like male, female, and something which don't have an order, you can't say that if it's 0.2, it's male. It's right. We can't do that. Therefore, there is no order as such. There is, because numerical values have a order. The algorithm is learning that in case it's too high, go this side. Right. So when it predicts 1.5, 1.8, it doesn't make any sense, right? Therefore, instead of whenever you see a such kind of scenario, the way you think of it is, what happens when we have a decimal number in between? If we have 1.5, does it make sense? No. Therefore, such variables are the most important way of converting such columns, such categories into decimal is by the way of using one hot encoding. All right?
Understood. Awesome. So I think that's a lot of information and very good session to get started with machine learning. Thanks a lot for joining. We are almost on 5 minutes, 10 minutes late. So that's okay. I think as long as the doubts are clear, and I hope you are already reachable. You are reachable through social media, your professional LinkedIn and everything. I would like you to say any last thing or that you have any message for the audience.
All right. So first of all, I'm really thankful to InviteLab and Pradeep. You guys are doing a wonderful job. And I look forward to see a bigger interaction going forth. We want to make it this particular event. I want to see it as one of the largest event across the globe, and it has great potential. And thank you for inviting me to talk over. I enjoyed the entire session, and I enjoyed your question. And I'm very happy that being the founder, being the main person in the event, you yourself are trying out things with me. So I'm extremely happy to be part of this. So thank you, everyone, those who attended. I hope that I was able to add some value to your life. Your 1 hour was not a waste of time. Important time for you. All right. So thank you, everyone. I look forward to interact with you. Come over to my LinkedIn connections. It's quite, I have quite a good network, and I'm pretty active there. So if you have any questions related to learning machine learning, big data, or if you have a problem, hard problem that you're trying to solve in data engineering or machine learning, feel free to reach out to us. And all right. So that's pretty much. So thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Awesome. Thanks a lot for joining in, Sandeep. That's a really insightful session. And I hope the audience, and including me, I got to learn really good thing about machine learning. And I used to have this, barrier that get started with machine learning. This session breaks that barrier, and I think this could be a starting point of a journey of learning machine learning. And thanks a lot. You have been a wonderful speaker. Thanks a lot for accepting our request to speak here to the audience, to the community. And thanks a lot for your wishes. And on behalf of all Git Commit Show organizing team, thanks a lot. And I would love to see you again with part 2 of this learning machine learning. Thanks a lot.
Bye.
See you then.